In this video, we quickly derive the expression for the force on a current carrying wire in a magnetic field, and then we apply the new formula to an example. So in the picture on the left, we're looking at a current carrying wire in a magnetic field, and there's an angle of theta between the direction of current and the direction of the field. Now we know the charge carriers in a wire are actually the electrons, but it doesn't cause any problem to pretend that positive charge is moving here, and it just simplifies the analysis a little bit. So we're going to pretend there's positive charges moving along in the wire, and that's what accounts for this current, I. Remember that the charge carriers in a conductor move with an average speed called the drift velocity, and I'll post a link to that derivation real quick. So the first thing I want to do is get an expression relating the current to the drift velocity. We have to make an assumption here about the density of charge carriers in the conductive material. So we're going to use a little n for this. That's the charge per cubic meter of material that's able to move. And a common assumption here is that that's one free charge that's able to move per atom of the material. So these are the charges that get shared from atom to atom as they drift over long distances in the material. N would be measured in coulombs per cubic meter of free charge. So we allow a time of delta t to go by, and we watch all the charge passing this point in the wire. And the charge that passes that point traces out a cylinder. So the goal here is to find the volume of that cylinder, and then we can find out how much charge has passed in a time of delta t. First, we need the length of the cylinder, and that's already been given to us in the diagram. The delta x there is given by the average speed, that's the drift velocity multiplied by delta t. The amount of charge that's passed this point of interest during that time delta t is equal to the volume of the cylinder multiplied by the density of free charge in that cylinder. I'm going to call that delta q. Again, that little n is the charge per cubic meter, so I need how many cubic meters of charge have gone by in a time of delta t, and that's given by the volume of the cylinder, which is the area of the base times the length of the thing. This means I can write down a new expression for current as the amount of charge per time flowing through the wire. Delta q divided by delta t, and that's just Na times the drift velocity of the charge carriers. Next, we use the Lorentz force law to find the force on this little section of moving charge. And I'll post a link real quick to where the Lorentz force law was first introduced. And the Lorentz force law goes like this. If I'm looking at the force on this little section of charge in here, the magnetic force on that little charge is given by the size of the charge times the speed of it, and we're using an average speed of drift velocity here, times the magnetic field magnitude, times the sine of the angle between the velocity and the magnetic field, which was labeled as theta in the diagram. And the direction of this force is given by a right-hand rule, where we point our fingers in the direction of the velocity, sweep out to the direction of the magnetic field, and our thumb points in the direction of the force. So in this case, that's out of the page. Well, we already found that our delta Q is given by this expression. Now, recalling that this little VD times delta T is really just delta X, I can write down my delta Q as Na delta X. But then I remember that my current is given by Na times the drift velocity. So I can rewrite this as I delta X times B sine theta. And finally, we arrive at our force per unit length on the current carrying conductor. I divide both sides by delta X, and I get the force per length here is IB sine theta. To clarify what I mean by force per length, the units of it would be newtons per meter. So if I put twice as much wire in this magnetic field, I get twice the force. I think that makes a lot of sense. Now, a common style of application here is you would be given the length of the wire, and you would have to multiply the force per unit length by the length to get the total force. And that's actually what we do in our example. So I'm given 1.5 centimeters of wire running at right angles to a 0.8 Tesla magnetic field. Well, that means the sine theta part is going to turn into a 1. I have 1 amp of current running in this wire, and I want to get the magnitude and direction of the force on this section of wire. So let's just deal with the direction first. If I put my fingers in the direction of the current and sweep out to the direction of the magnetic field, I'm going to get an upward force. So we've got the direction. I'll call that FB from magnetic. And after that, I'm just plugging into my new formula. I have my force per unit length. I could call it F over delta X or F over L depending on the textbook. That's given by I times B because the angle is 90 degrees, so sine theta is 1. And I get 1 amp times 0.8 teslas, which gives me 0.8 newtons per meter for the force per unit length. Then I take my 0.8 newtons per meter and I multiply by how many meters of wire are exposed to this magnetic field, and that's 0.015, changing the centimeters into meters. And I get 0.012 newtons of force out of this, and that's pointing up. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.